Welcome to Tech Brainstalk with your girl Flavella Fongang, and today I'm gonna fuel your brain with some bomb knowledge. Are you ready? Let's do it. Hey everybody, welcome back for another episode of Tech Brainstalk. Thank you for listening. Make sure you tell everybody about this amazing podcast. And I'm so happy to have you back. And today we're going to be talking about developing a successful prospecting funnel. Yes, it's super, super key. But also, it's a bit like two for the price of one. We're also going to be talking about how 3D can support brand experiences during social distancing. And obviously, we're in a situation where we're trying to cope with a situation people want to buy, but they can't buy because they've been asked to stay at home. So obviously a bit more flexibility, but we're not obviously back to the normal that we knew before. And I'm super happy because I have an amazing individual with me, Mark Charalambos. And oh my gosh, when you're going to hear about what he has to say, you're going to be like, wow, this is great. So Mike is a co-founder and CEO of 3DM, which is specializing in 3D experiences. And I'm going to tell you more about that because it's super good as well. But he's also a passionate entrepreneur with international experience in the launch and development growth of new innovative businesses. He has worked with startups, but also multinational companies globally in sectors such as retail, of course, food and beverage, tourism and telecommunications. And also prior to commencing his journey in 3DM, the business that we're going to be talking about today, he had already had two successful exits. So this is not even his first business. Don't worry, he's not like, it doesn't look like he's 55. And I know he's not 55. And from his past venture in entertainment and ad tech. Mike, so good to have you. How are you?
Hey, Flavella, thank you so, so much. What a great intro. I'm blushing and you make it sound better than real life.
Please, don't be so modest. You're brilliant and you've done some great things. That's the reason why you are on this podcast. And I want, you know, obviously, I give you a bit of an intro to what you do, but I would love to learn a bit more of your journey. We're going to talk a bit more details, but tell us about how did you find yourself now, you know, involved in 3DM? How did the business was born? How did that happen?
Honestly, everything started over beers and nachos and very spicy food. It was back at the time where I was still leading the growth of a different company called Frenzy Media, which was a company specializing in interactive advertising. And we were looking to collaborate with the guys at 3DM, which at the time they were doing some interesting 3D projects with some high-end brands. And I always felt that their 3D was quite good. It was promising and I could totally see that it could be something that people will talk about often in the future. Now, this was back in 2016. So we met with the guys to discuss how we could collaborate with them and what I was doing at the time with Frenzy and interactive advertising. And then, you know, when you meet someone and you can instantly say that, oh, you know, there's a chemistry here. You know, these guys are, we were meant to cross paths. So one beer led to the other. Our discussions ended up over some obnoxiously drunk moments in the pub. And then the next day we emailed each other and we're like, we need to find a way to work together. We met more formally in a more sober state. And we agreed that there was definitely some grounds to collaborate between their 3D experts and their technology and our platform. So we managed to get a couple of projects together through some media agency briefs, which we nailed. We did some initial 3D advertising for brands such as Starbucks and BMW. And the results were absolutely insanely good. We never felt that combining 3D display with interactive advertising could get people so excited about a product. And straight after we realized the potential, the investors were invested in 3D in Frenzy, they suggested that we should try and find a way to form a strategic partnership with Dushan, Loden, and Jose, who were the guys that were part of Modular, which was at the time the name of their company. And then their investors in Modular, they suggested that, hey, 3D Frenzy guys are good, but we cannot do a strategic partnership. It won't make sense for the intellectual property. Let's try and merge the two companies together. They formed like a consortium of investors, which basically they hired the team members of Frenzy Media, myself, my co-founder at the time, Kiri, and also our creative director. So we became part of 3DM. We received the respective shareholding within the company, plus some cash exchange. And we formally formed the new entity, which was called 3Dium, and consisted of five founders. Myself, Kiri, my co-founder from Frenzy, Dushan, who is the major shareholder of 3Dium and our CTO, Lot, who is our commercial chief officer and also co-founder, and Jose, who is our head of sales, head of client solution. And after that, it was just an insane journey towards something bigger than ourselves. Since we formed the company in 2017, that was around April 2017, we've been growing in numbers and growing in clients. We started as a team of five. Now, towards the end of 2020, we're a team of 23. We've got our headquarters in the UK, another smaller office in Serbia, in Belgrade. And we've recently opened a smaller subsidiary in Germany to facilitate our growth in the German market as well.
And Mike, I think there's something you need to say, because I think, you know, one thing that obviously when we look at the industry, when we look at the 3D environment or what, how has always been served, you guys have done it differently. You really simplified it. Do you want to tell us more about that?
Absolutely. Yes. So, and that's a good question. Thanks for emphasizing it. So yeah, what 3Dium does in a nutshell, and shame of me that I did not define it straight away, is that we are the Shopify for 3D and AR. So we make 3D and AR technologies much less complicated to develop and launch. You can launch them much faster, and you can definitely launch them without breaking the bank. And for the reason of making the entire process so simple, so streamlined, so automated, we started seeing so many different brands, so many different agencies across so many different industries reaching out to use our technology and deploy it within their online buying strategies. It's such a modular technology, such an easy technology to be implemented that we've got brands such as Diageo, Sainsbury's, Disney, BMW, Nissan, Mercedes, JD Sports using it. But we also got hundreds of Shopify and Wix users also on our platform using it as well. So you can instantly understand that it has a very multi-purpose focus, and it's applicable universally, regardless of what kind of budget you have as a company. So our purpose was to actually break the myth that 3D experiences are complicated, timely to build, and expensive to launch. And we are doing a great job, I think, so far in disrupting this whole industry expectation. Yes.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are. I think this democratization of an industry that is always been perceived as only accessible to a certain size of businesses. Now anybody can now use 3D, and which is extremely big difference. So anybody's listening to this podcast and thinking, oh my gosh, I'm looking at, you know, changing and disruptive an industry that has been, you know, established for such a long time and things are not changing. This is a perfect example that things can be done if you really challenge yourself and create a technology as such to, you can make it work for everybody.
Absolutely.
So
yeah.
Mine's really good already. I think that's good. So obviously the title of the podcast was around, you know, successfully, you know, prospecting and developing your own funnel. So I'm interested in terms of, was we're going to talk about, you know, a quick customer acquisition. Obviously, you guys, you know, people are not familiar with funnel. You need to wake up. You need to figure out why is this so important. And I'm curious in terms of what has been your success in, you know, developing funnel.
Yeah. So like every other company, we also found it quite hard at the beginning to truly nail down our target audience. You know, when you start, you feel that you want to sell to everybody. You feel that everybody can use this. You feel that your solution is so good that nobody can say no to. But, you know, then reality kicks in, and then you realize, you know, damn, I really need to focus and narrow down the people I have to spend my precious time to chat with and possibly bring in as warm leads and then potentially as paid client. We started rather messy in the whole journey. So I remember we used to go to different yacht and high-end luxury exhibitions. Back at the days where exhibitions were still a thing, we were going to different e-commerce managers of Chopard or of Chanel, and we were showcasing them a really nice 3D chair, and they were staring at us saying, okay guys, this is great, but how can you convince me, Chanel, to invest my budget into a 3D solution that is not a 3D jewelry example, you know? Or we used to go to, let's say, some high-end motor yachts, and we're trying to convince them that this 3D smartphone, which we developed, would look really good if we utilize the same technology for the motor yacht, because you can tell about the textures of the mobile and how shiny the surface is. So you can imagine it being as shiny, having the same shiny finish on your yacht. And they were staring at us. And obviously we left there with some great memories, but with zero client. So we went back and we revisited the whole thing. And then we said, okay, guys, listen, if we want to, if we want to grow this, we need to be much more, efficient and into the kind of discussions we have with clients and try and shorten the sales cycle even more. So what we did, we took a huge gamble. And first of all, we invested a lot of our time and a lot of our modelers' time to develop a bunch of different 3D solutions, which we knew that potentially would never be used, but at least it will give us a robust profile and showcase so that we can start to, tapping into different industries and showcasing them different potential examples of how 3D and augmented reality display of products in their industries could act as a use case and potentially bring results to them. Because we were still at the time not very courageous to say that we're not going to eliminate specific people from specific industries. We still wanted to reach out to all of them. So we basically went back. We had finally examples from every single industry, and then we began our social outreach again to different people on LinkedIn, and also to going to different exhibitions of different industries and showcasing more related examples in each industry. And that's where things started to pick up a bit more, because finally people could relate with the product. They could see how it can be used for their online strategies. And then discussions started happening. Now, of course, at the time, because we were pretty naive and we thought that, you know, we knew everything about each industry, which is not the case. Different industries have different challenges, especially in specific life cycles. Different people perceived it differently. So some people thought of 3D and AR as a great marketing and sales tool, and that's how we used to pitch it at the time. But other industries, especially around CPG and FMCG, they saw it as a great tool to enhance their product sampling, packaging, but also to enhance their quality assurance operations and as a back office. So we then started realizing that it should not be perceived as only as a one from one specific angle. We should always be much more receptive in feedback and be able to to try and accommodate every challenge and every way that the clients would see this fit into their strategy. Mm-hmm. And then this gave us even more experience and more insights as to how we should improve our communication and branding and outreach. So we then went back to the drawing board and we redefined our entire marketing and sales development strategy. So what we did was basically we created a media deck, which was showcasing the different ways that the 3D solutions can tap into the different aspects of a user's journey within any industry. So we gave them examples as to how 3D can be used in 3D banner ads for product, for brand awareness and product awareness, how it can be used, on homepages and, to make homepages of specific websites more enticing, more engaging, more interactive. But we also showed them how it can appear within product pages so that people can further explore the product, have a much more, autonomous browsing experience around the product when they customize it, when they change colors, when they spin it around and they're zooming it. But we also showed them how it can be used in supply chains and how people can scan objects in 3D, share them between the teams, see them in an augmented reality environment as well, so that they can understand if the product is ready, it has the necessary quality to be then pushed into the market instead of constantly having to ship it between the different countries and the departments and so on and so forth. So this media deck proved to be very, very powerful, and it helped us minimize our sales cycles from an average of 3 months to 1 month, even less. Brands could totally relate, and they were, and it was much easier in each of the teams to be able to draft a solid brief, send it to us, and then basically finalize all the nitty-gritty details to kickstart on a pilot campaign or on a full-blown project. The other thing which we realized along the way is that we spent an awful lot of time chasing both the enterprise clients, but also the lower budget type of clients. And this was not going to work because there's only a handful of hours every day which you can source in clients, and therefore you cannot waste the same amount of time to bring in a client that's going to sign an average contract value of, let's say, £1,000 versus a client that can sign an average contract value of 100K. So what we did is that we took another risk and we threw the dice and we said, guys, look, for basic clients, and we defined what a basic client is. Basically, it's a client that has an average contract value of anything between £1,000 per year to £10,000 per year. We will only reach out to them digitally. So we created this digital funnel where it consisted of different digital touch points where we threw our marketing budget on basically, and we created social media sponsored content, Google Ads, different PPC campaigns, and also retargeting. So we generated this marketing strategy basically online where we will only focus on people that have Shopify websites or Wix websites, or they are defined as companies that have less than 10 million revenue per year. And we created our target audience and whitelists in that digital marketing campaign. And we started reaching out to them digitally with our content. And for the enterprise clients, that's where we kept it a bit more manual. And we continued our own personal tapping into our own network to reach out to them, or we collaborated with various field agents, which we compensated with a success fee based on the different introductions they gave to us with different C-level people within the key industries and brands we identified we wanted to work with. And we also utilized a lot our network of investors and business angels, because at the end of the day, this is why you're willing to give shares of your company to investors and yes, NBCs, because you want to leverage on their network. You want to leverage on their experience in the game. And all these things together, they helped us a lot. First of all, to onboard these tremendous brands that I mentioned before, as clients and as users on our platform. And it also helped us to go to sleep at night, wake up in the morning and receive 10, 20, 30 requests per day from basic users wanting to either request for a lot of their products to turn to 3D or signing up automatically on our platform to start using it and launching 3D and AR. Mm-hmm. This is still early days, so we're constantly optimizing this funnel. We are seeing we're setting different objectives around both basic and enterprise clients. So once they're meet, we constantly optimize or revisit our marketing strategies for the both spectrums. But it's a funnel that it took us 2 years to shape up. It's now finally working, and we are now in a position to know that for every X amount of money I invest in these channels, I can forecast to receive X amount of return after a month, after 6 months, after 12 months. So we're in a position now to feel more confident with what we've designed.
You share some really, really valuable information in terms of how you segment as well, because as you explained, you know, you might have a product that that will be used differently for different type of customers, or you have a product that can serve, you know, people with a bigger budget and a smaller budget. So therefore, if you have people where you are looking for volume, so therefore the power of having an automated, semi-automated funnel where, you know, you have some clarity in advertisement, in your advertising and how you're doing things will help you go much faster. But again, something when you're trying to win a bigger customer, that's where building strong relationships, you know, going for your networks makes a big, big difference, which is really good value point. And I hope everybody listening to this right now can really think about how they can reevaluate the way they, you know, they prospect and the way they search for, you know, the sales process. Really, there's no one method. I think it's just, you know, as I say, you know, you keep on trying. You know, Mike, I've tried for, with team tried for 2 years.
Yeah.
Sounds like, you know, a long time, but at the same time, 2 years go really fast. But 2 years, if you don't have a cash flow, you know, that can be quite hard. And that's where, you know, having the support of investors as well, you know, help you stay a bit longer. you know, so absolutely. Really, really good.
It always varies between companies, between industries, between the type of products you're promoting. For instance, with us, the reason that it took 2 years is because it's a rather new technology. So it was kind of hard to understand how people perceive it. But it depends what you want to do. It depends in which industry you want to focus and what kind of clients you're chasing. And the reason it took 2 years is because we were still debating as to who is the ideal client for us and where do they usually spend most of their time. So people, before defining their digital strategy and their marketing strategy and their sales development strategy, they should always think, okay, where do my clients spend most of their time? Where do I see a much higher engagement on my branding and my communication content with the minimum money invested? And how do I make sure that that target audience that I wish to entice will always have the feel that my company, my logo is always surrounding them? So you need to create, as you mentioned, Fabiola, as well, a variety of touch points and make sure that you always try and bombard that small cycle, that small segment of people that you want to source in as warm leads with different techniques, different digital channels to feel that you're always around them, to feel that you're always present, even though for you, you know that you're only targeting those guys, so it's not going to cost you an arm and a leg to do so. So yeah, it's more about being strategic and understanding the true impact of digital marketing and the different touch points you have to build in order to keep everyone informed and connected and aware all the time.
Such golden information you just shared, Mike. Really, really good. And I really advise anybody listening to this episode to listen to it again and take some notes if you haven't. It's really, really good. And everything that's said makes complete sense. You know, test and error. Keep on trying until you have the formula, that work for your business. You know, I want to talk to you more about the COVID-19 mm-hmm. pandemic has really disturbed, you know, retail. Forget about, you know, shopping therapy, you know, right now, you know, people are not, obviously we are, you know, back, you know, shops are open, you know, but it's still not the same. I think people are not spending as much and they're concerned. But I've heard, you know, obviously I heard that ASUS has done really, really well online. Amazon has done really, really well online. Those companies, online companies, or people who didn't have a digital presence had to quickly adapt. So tell us about why 3D is so relevant right now to really maintain that experience as well for customers.
So you're absolutely right. And even though we don't want to boast too much about how we actually seen a growth during the pandemic months, because there are people that actually suffered a lot about it. But the truth is because of this drastic change in consumer behavior and the fact that people are now more reluctant to walk on high streets and go into shops where there's a lot of different human interaction, they obviously tend to favor to shop online. Now, what makes 3D and AR a perfect tool for the online shopping experience, especially for users, is that because they know that probably they won't have the time nor the ability to go into a store and finally see a product from close and explore it and see if it matches their space or if it matches their body type and so on and so forth. And they know that they're very restricted to only make a purchasing decision through online, that there needs to be some visual support from the brand side that will help them to feel more confident to press that buy button and buy something online without actually ever seeing it physically in front of them. So enters 3DUM or enters 3D AR immersive technologies. The way that the products are rendered into 3D and AR to be able to have this immense photorealistic quality and give you an almost 100% like-to-like representation of the product as it is in the physical world, it makes, as I mentioned before, the users to build much more rapport, much more confidence around the product that they're browsing. Also the ability that they have this autonomy in the way they browse the product. They don't just swipe back and forth and see different static image, but they actually interact with the product. They can use their fingers to zoom in, zoom out. They can orbit it. They can click and see it physically in front of them, or they can see that sneaker shoe on their feet, or they can see that t-shirt on their body, or they can see that perfect armchair within their living room space, or that barbecue outside in their balcony, or that bicycle unfolding or folding in front of them in their garage, or that car in their garage even, sky's the limit as to what you want to explore. 3D and AR help make this process much more viable, and they give that oomph and that credibility that I was talking about for the end user to choose it from. Now, what made Freedium quite a hit during those months that brands were looking to quickly turnkey a lot of their products in 3D and AR was, again, the ability for the platform to compress and render all these products in high volumes quite fast with unprecedented speed. So we were able to turnkey 20, 30, 100 different products in 3D within a matter of days. And we were able to launch them on different brand sites and retail sites within a matter of minutes. And brands were also simultaneously able to deploy augmented reality features around those 3D display products instantly. So they didn't have to pay twice to render something in 3D, make it 3D interactive on their site, and then incorporate the AR feature. With one go, they could have everything ready and integrated on their site. And this is why it helped them to launch quite fast and start seeing the positive results and impact it had on their conversion.
Wow, sounds so good. And I think it's, you know, when you look at a situation like that, people would have, you know, would have just stayed and not adapt. And you realize people have a craving for being able to still serve customers. And if you're able to provide a product, you know, quite fast, I think that's what people want right now. Everybody wants everything to yesterday.
Yes.
So if you have a product, it is quite, you know, you give people the, you know, give them the choice to do it themselves, but also the speed. Well, that's great. And as well, obviously, as you mentioned, the Shopify, you know, those websites and those companies have done really well because they were able to boost it at scale.
Correct. And if we want to see this also from a technical perspective, because, yeah, let's say it looks good, it feels good, it even performs well, but you know, what is the catch? How difficult is it on the back end to have all this stuff ready? You know, because up until today, people only knew that you can have content generated through photography and you have to have studios and models and create videos. So with the 3D technology, what we managed to educate brands and agencies during the COVID period is that you really don't need to have anyone collaborating in the same room to have this stuff ready and up and running. So all you need to do is just upload 4 images that you had of a specific product, or just upload the 3D files like we had previously of that product on the platform. And the platform will instantly spit them out in interactive 3D and AR files, which they can then be used. So you don't need to keep people in the same room. You don't need to spend hours of reserving studios or booking models and photographers and spend hours of editing pictures before you push them live on your different online shops. They can be done much faster. And the other important thing is, again, around the aspect of sustainability in a way, because you don't need to waste any resources in order to have all this content ready, nor having to ship products back and forth. So everything adds up, and it really helps making the whole content generation process much more efficient and also help brands save a lot on the cost of production.
Mike, can I ask you a question? Does 3D impact on the return, the item returned, or not at all? Have you noticed anything like that?
I mean, I really don't want to always overpromise or oversell something. We never designed this technology thinking that we're going to massively reduce product returns. But what we're seeing from various case studies of clients using our technology to sell online, they are noticing an average of 8% drop on their product returns, which again has some positive effects, not just across your cash flow, but also to the fact that they don't need to spend extra resources or shipping resources back and forth products.
Yes. It's also good for the environment.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
We could be talking about this all day, and I can sense that. We're going to take a short break and be back in a second.